Did you know Walt Disney was fired by a newspaper editor because he lacked imagination and had no good ideas? Thomas Edison was told by his school teachers that he was too stupid to learn anything. Winston Churchill failed sixth grade and lost every public office role he ran for before he became prime minister at 62. Harrison Ford, after his first small movie role, he was taken into an executive's office and told he would never make it in the movie business. Vincent van Gogh sold only one painting in his entire life. No wonder he chopped off his ear. Beethoven was told by his music teacher that he was a hopeless composer. Abraham Lincoln lost an embarrassing 8 elections, couldn't get into law school, failed at business twice, and had a nervous breakdown before he became our 16th president. The same is true with the Bible characters. Elijah was moody. Moses had temper problems. David killed somebody and had an affair. Paul tried to kill Christians. Jonah went in the opposite direction God called him to preach in. And Peter denied Jesus 3 times when a little girl peer pressured him. So why are you letting your failure stop you from your destiny? Fear no failure except the fear of failure. Because even though you and I might fail, God's love never fails. And that's what counts. Because it ain't about how high we climb. It's about how high you bounce back when you hit the bottom. Jesus like gets kicked at his disciples in a storm. He's like, why do you have such little faith? Why pace the deck when the great captain is behind the wheel? So be still and know that I am God. And I am still, Jesus says, and I know my Father is God, and I'll be still in sleep during a storm. And then I will say to the storm, be still, and the stillness in my heart will bleed over into my circumstances. And then the storm will be still. But first, I've got to make the decision to be strong and of good courage. And then he will strengthen my heart because I've made the action to hope in the Lord. Would somebody please say church? Welcome to Hope Generation. My name's Ben Courson. You just took in a quick look of our last episode entitled, Who Art Thou, O Mountain? And we're about to take in the final part of this message. Now, I'm really excited about this because I believe that hope is for every human. Paul said the 3 most important things in life, 1 Corinthians 13:13, are faith, hope, and love. We all need hope. It's the universal language. Whether you're depressed, and you need to be the fulfillment of the promise in Psalms that the Lord is nigh unto the brokenhearted? Or whether you're happy and you need more hope to attempt great things for God, expect great things from God, and pursue your teleologic design and purpose all the more passionately, we are all gonna live life better when we have a greater deal of hope. So let's take in the conclusion of our teaching, Who Art Thou, O Mountain? Let's take a look at our text tonight, Matthew chapter 17. As we understand that we embark on mission possible, because he is the God of hope. Let's take a look, Matthew chapter 17, verse 20. Because of your unbelief, for verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Now, as you know, we like to do this. We like, whenever we study a text, to study the context behind the text and understand what it was like for Jesus' first century Israelite audience. What did that mean? When Jesus said, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you can say to a mountain, be thou removed, and it will obey. What did this mean? What you have to get is that phrase, moving mountains, was a proverb. It was like a popular saying in Jesus's day. For example, if you had a very great Rabboni, a very great teacher, who could expound to you a very difficult and complicated text, that teacher was regularly called a mountain remover. For example, if you would ask your pastor, can God build a rock so big that he can't lift it? And if your pastor is able to explicate and explain to you an answer that justifies and titillates your curiosity and justifies the truth of who God is, even in a paradoxical question, if a rabbi is really good at explaining difficult theology to somebody, in the first century, that Rabboni, that Jewish teacher, was nicknamed a mountain remover. Sometimes they even called them mountain pulverizers. In other contexts, they called them mountain uprooters. So when you read the book of Revelation, you're like, I don't know what this means. And then up comes a pastor who says, Revelation is not a hard book to understand. It comes with its own divine outline. Then you're like, mountain remover, awesome. But be that as it may, you got to understand, these rabbis, Jesus was looked at as a Rabboni, as a rabbi. That's what he was called. He was coming first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. He's like, why would I give crumbs to the dogs when I've come first for the children at the table? I've come first for a certain people group. Jesus, remember, he never went outside of his country. He always stayed in Israel. The only time Jesus ever preached outside of Israel was when he went to Tyre and Sidon, and that was just barely outside of the Israelite borders. And that was only for a very brief period of time. It was Paul the Apostle who went to Rome and Greece and Turkey and Ephesus and Galatia and Corinth and Mars Hill and Athens. But Jesus, he stayed ministering to Jews. And to the Jewish audience to which he was speaking, to say, if you say to this mountain, be thou removed or be pulverized or be uprooted, that was, listen, a proverb in Jesus's day. Historically, that was a proverb. That's the context behind the text. That meant, write this down if you're taking notes. Remember, 99% of people who take notes always get into heaven. But Jesus, I'm joking. Jesus, when he said, you can remove mountains with faith, nothing will be impossible to you. That proverb, removing mountains, was a metaphor for, listen, removing obstacles and overcoming difficulties. That's what it meant. It didn't necessarily mean that you stare at a mountain and you use the force and you toss it into the Dagobah system pond. Sure. How many of you when you were a kid, like you would look at the dishwasher and your mom would say, unload the dishwasher. You're like, I think I can move this with telekinesis and the force. And those little doubts say, I don't think you can. I don't believe it. But then the little Yoda pops up on your shoulder and he says, that is why you fail. And you think, I can do this. I used to do this as a kid. I would sit there, like, you were a lonely kid. Yes, I was, but be that as it may, didn't have a whole lot of friends. Just sat there and tried to use the force. And I would try so hard to move that spoon. I would try so hard to use telekinesis on that fork. I would try so hard to face that mountain and face my fears. And I would try to move stuff. But the truth of the matter was, I couldn't. Because Jesus was not talking about using parlor tricks. So it's like, watch how you can impress your friends when you move mountains. This proverb in Jewish culture meant you can overcome any difficulty. You can remove any obstacle in your way. It doesn't mean that you just lazily sit there because I don't want to do the dishes, so I'm going to use the force on those forks. No, listen, faith can move mountains, but don't be surprised if God hands you a shovel. Come on. I'm going to talk from my heart for just a second, okay? When we talk about faith and prayer and removing difficulties and removing obstacles, one of my pet peeves is when people say, like when a dad says, son, mow the lawn, and here's our generation. When a dad says, son, mow the lawn, the son says, okay, I'll pray about that. It's like, that's not what Jesus is talking about. Or like, you know, when you need to dump somebody, you're like, yeah, I just feel like the Lord told me to break up with you. It's like, don't say that, Christianese. You're making God dump the girl for you because you're a coward. Dump her yourself and man up. I'm speaking to myself because when I was a kid, I dumped a girl at church and I said, God told me to do this. And then all the other girls I dated dumped me. But be that as it may, I think it's interesting how faith and work go hand in hand. This is kind of what a lot of James is about. It's not faith and works, it's faith that works. Like Abraham is justified by his faith and his works, meaning he showed his faith by his works when he offered Isaac on the altar, and then the angel stopped him, and Jehovah Jireh, God the provider, gave him a ram in the thicket that he could sacrifice. But faith and work go hand in hand. It's not a guilt trip, it's this. It's faith. When you have real faith, it ends up working harder than doubt. When you doubt, you always second guess yourself, and you're always paralyzed by inaction. But when you approach something in the spirit of faith, you actually end up working harder and becoming more effective. Faith can move mountains, but don't be surprised if God hands you a shovel, because the Bible talks a lot about hard work. The book of Proverbs says, hard work leads to prosperity. Only fools idle away their time. Again, the book of Proverbs says in the New Living Translation, work hard and you will become a leader. Be lazy and become a slave. The book of Proverbs says, the diligent hand leads to plenty. So I'm just a really big believer that if God's given you a dream, if God's given you a prayer request, go for it. But you also shouldn't be discouraged if God hands you a shovel and says, okay, now I want you to work really hard for 10 years. You know, I'm a big believer in Malcolm Gladwell's Outliers. It's just proving the Proverbs that when they study the science of anybody who masters their craft, they literally have to practice their craft for 10,000 hours. So for example, there's a study done on this. When the Beatles came to America during the British invasion, all of the American girls were shrieking and all of the pundits were amazed and all the journalists were like, who are these mop top boys from Liverpool? But what they didn't understand is that the Beatles had just come back from Hamburg, Germany, where they were playing shows 7 days a week for 8 hours a day at a club in Hamburg, Germany. And by the time the Beatles came to America, before they ever even came to the US coasts, before they ever came to our country, did you know the Beatles had played more shows live than most bands do in their entire career before they ever came to America? And went on, was it Johnny Carson? Who was that guy? Ed Sullivan, before they ever went on the Ed Sullivan show. The same is true of Bobby Fischer, the chess master. You're like, wow, he was 13 years old when he became a chess master. Well, that's because he was a toddler practicing all day, every day. It took him 9 years to master his craft. Beethoven, they're like, oh man, he's just a prodigy. He's so good because he could compose when he was six. But what people don't know is that Mozart, did I say Mozart or Beethoven? I meant Mozart. Mozart, when he was a child prodigy, he was composing at six. But really what they found is Mozart's first real masterpiece came in his late 20s. So he was a late bloomer. It took him 20 years to produce his first real masterpiece. Before that, he was more copying other people's works to learn his craft. What I'm trying to say is hockey players, celloists, pianists, master criminals, science fiction writers, whatever craft you're talking about, they found that you have to practice for 10,000 hours. But a study came out, and I read this recently, that blew my mind. Listen to this. A study came out that by the age of 21, the average American by the age of 21 has played 10,000 hours of video games. Now, if you're gonna be a gamer for the rest of your life, and that's possible, that's really cool. But if you're not a gamer, I'm just asking, is that where we wanna spend all of our time? Is that what God has called us to do? Do we wanna say, when I die, I was a master World of Warcraft legend? Or do we wanna say, no, I waged a good warfare, as Paul told Timothy, and I fought not some orcs, but I fought some demons. Are you picking up what I'm throwing down? So sometimes it means you got to say, I'm not afraid if God makes me work for a while. That's what the Proverbs teach. The diligent hand leads to plenty. And sometimes that means we got to work. So faith can move mountains. Don't get me wrong. Faith can move mountains. But don't be surprised if God hands you a shovel, because faith is produced in works, James says. Are you following? Okay, then listen to this. Notice what our text says. Jesus, in this particular text, did not say to God, remove the mountain. He said, say to the mountain, be thou removed. And if you believe when you speak to the mountain that it can be removed, it will obey you. It's not just about saying, well, I'm going to pray about it. We need to pray about it. The Bible says, pour out your heart to God at all times. The Bible says, pray without ceasing. We should be praying all the time. That's, of course. But in this text, Jesus, the context is not saying in prayer, although that applies, the literal translation is you say to your, you start talking to your difficulty. You start actually speaking God's word over your difficulty. You say to your difficulty or your obstacle, be removed. And there's power in your words. The Bible says that the power of life and death is in the tongue. And I know how much faith is in my heart by the kind of words that I speak. Listen to this. Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So when I have a mustard seed of faith in my heart, I suddenly speak it out and the obstacles are removed. My words are the mirror of my heart. And when I say to the mountain, be thou removed, it will obey. Don't tell your God how big your mountain is. Tell your mountain how big your God is. That's what Jesus is saying. Nothing will be impossible unto you when you're telling your God how big your, when you're telling your mountain how big your God is. Don't measure the size of your mountain. Talk to the one who can move it. Now, I have a theory, and I don't know if this is true. I have a theory that Jesus got this idea from Zechariah. I can't prove it, but I do think that maybe Jesus that day was reading in his devotions the scroll of Zechariah. You say, why? In Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6 through 7, Zechariah is speaking the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, who is leading the Jewish exile back to Canaan, the land flowing with milk and honey, to rebuild the temple that was dilapidated. And when Zerubbabel, how cool is that name, by the way? Zerubbabel. When Zerubbabel comes back to Israel, he has this really big project. He's got to rebuild a temple, and it's got to be really well done. This is going to have the Holy of Holies, the Shekinah Kabod glory presence of God. It was a big task. It was a big mountain. And in Zechariah 4, 6, I love this. Zechariah said, thus saith the Lord, it is not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. That temple is going to be constructed. Do you know what he says in the next verse? Zechariah 4, 7. He says, this is one of my favorite verses right now. Who art thou, O great mountain? What? That's old King James 4. Who do you think you are, mountain? What's Zechariah doing? He is speaking to the mountain. He said, before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain. What's he saying? It's plain to you that before Zerubbabel, the mountain will become rubble before Zerubbabel. The mountain before Zerubbabel will become rubble. So I'm saying to you, I'm trash talking my mountain. Who do you think you are? Who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you shall become rubble. And then when they laid the final headstone of the temple, because God who begins a good work will be faithful to complete it, as they did not despise the day of small beginnings, they finally constructed the temple. And the Bible says in Zechariah 4, 7, that they then spoke over the project, grace, grace unto it. That's what you got to start doing in your life. When God gives you a dream, when God gives you a prayer request, when God gives you a promise, when God gives you a project, you start talking differently. I speak faith over it. I speak grace, grace over it. Grace, grace. That's all I'm going to say. Grace, grace. That's what Zechariah said. Grace, grace into this project. And what do you say to your mountain? You're going to be destroyed. You condemn your mountain and you commend your God in your project. You speak grace over your project and you trash talk that mountain. You be lovey-dovey with your project. But you be a fiend with your mountain. You be like the God who has feathers, Psalm 90, with your grace to my project. But to my mountain, it's Exodus 15:3. It's on like Donkey Kong. God is a warrior, and I'm going to endure hardships as a good soldier of Jesus Christ, and the weapons of my warfare will pull down strongholds. And you start speaking, who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain. But to my project, grace, grace. It's got nothing but favor. The more desperate the case, the more room for God's grace. Grace, grace. I'm going to be strong when everything's going wrong. My past supply ain't my last supply. God's hope is the coal that makes the train roll. The more desperate the case, the more room for God's grace. My past supply ain't my last supply. Grace, grace. You start changing the way you talk, and that's the revealer, really, of your heart. That's what Jesus is saying. Same thing that Zechariah said. Start talking to your mountain. Be thou removed. Don't tell your God how big your mountain is. Tell your mountain how big your God is. That's what Joel believed. The prophet Joel said, listen, let the weak say I am strong. It doesn't mean you feel strong. It means you choose to say, I am strong. You say, but Ben, I feel weak. Well, 2 Corinthians 12 says, when you are weak, he is strong. His grace is sufficient for you. Speak grace, grace. His grace is sufficient for you, and his strength is made perfect in your weakness. It's not by might, nor by power, nor by strength, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. So even when you're weak, you're strong, because the weaker you are, the more you have to hang out with God. And the more you rely on God, the more his strength rubs off on you, because you become like who you hang out with. And the more his strength rubs off on you, the more powerful you become. Therefore, when you're weak, then you're actually strong, for his grace is sufficient for you. Who art thou, O mountain? Would somebody say, church? That's how we got to talk. As I begin to draw to a close, there are three people in the world. There are the people who make things happen. There are the people who watch things happen. And there are the people who wonder, what happened? As I said last week, one day your life is going to flash before your eyes. Make sure it's worth watching. At the end of your life, you will want to say, if the band could come up at this time, well, that's not what you're going to want to say at the end of your life. My last words, may the band come up at this time. The heavenly angels sing as I enter into the kingdom. But at the end of your life, are you going to say, you know what? I spoke over my project. Who art thou, O project? And I said to my mountain, oh, grace, grace to the mountain. That's where the mountain is strong. Or are you going to say, I'm going to trash talk my obstacles, and I'm going to speak grace over my projects. Friends, you have the God of hope. You are embarking on Mission Possible. You have received the exceeding great and precious promises of God, and all the promises of God in him are yes and amen. Today, may we speak differently. Let the weak, Joel said, say, I am strong. Let us say, I go from glory to glory. I go from grace to grace. I go from strength to strength. As my days are, so shall my strength be. And if I'm sad, he turns my sorrow into joy. And if I'm mourning, he turns my mourning into dancing. And if I feel naked and exposed, listen to this, he puts off my sackcloth and girds me with gladness and gives me garments of praise in exchange for the spirit of heaviness. And if I'm crying, I'm going to hear the words of Jesus to the widow from Nain. Weep not, because weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. If I can't see clearly because my eyes are blurred by tears, I'm going to hear the Bible say, if you sow in tears, then you will reap in joy. We're going to say with the psalmist, then was our mouth filled with laughter, for they said among the heathen, the Lord hath done great things for them. We're going to say like Jehoshaphat, I don't know what to do, but my eyes are on you. We're going to say like Jonathan and his armor bearer, the Lord can save by many or by few. We're going to say like the prophet Isaiah, his ear is not too dull that it cannot hear. His arm is not too short that it cannot say. We're going to say like Moses, let the weak say, I am strong. We're going to say like Moses, you will be the head and not the tail. You will be above and not beneath. We're going to say like the psalmist, be still and know that I am God, for I will be exalted among the nations. We're going to say like Solomon, the desire of the righteous will be granted. The blessing of the Lord makes one rich. He adds no sorrow with it. And when we're bullied and surrounded by enemies, we're going to trash talk our fears. We're going to say, I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people who have set themselves against me all around. And even if we feel scared, that's okay. It's not by might. It's not by power. It's by my spirit, saith the Lord. For the Lord your God is a sun. He is a shield. He will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. We're going to say like David, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? And even if you're orphaned today, you can say, even if my father and mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me. I know some of you have come with afflictions, but you can speak tonight. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. The Lord is nigh to the brokenhearted, and he saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. He healeth the brokenhearted and bindeth up their wounds. Happy are those people whose God is the Lord, whose hope is in the God of Jacob, who made heaven, the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. We're going to say, the Lord your God in the midst of you, he is mighty. He will save. He will rest in his love. He will restore the years the locusts have eaten. He will work all things together for the good. So blessed are you even if you're persecuted, because your reward is great in heaven. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for so they persecuted the prophets who came before you. This is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask today anything according to his will, we know that he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, we know we have the petitions that we have asked of him, because God's listening. He's tapped into souls like the FBI is tapped into phones. He's listening. We get to go through life today saying, behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us, that we should be called sons of God. We're going to say the words of Jesus. He said, my words are spirit and life. Like Abraham, we're going to judge him faithful to his promise, as he hoped against hope for the promises of God. We're going to say, is anything too hard for the Lord? We're going to say with Paul the Apostle, I have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. I know you might be going through hard times, but we can also say with Paul the Apostle, we might be hard pressed on every side, but we are not crushed. We might be perplexed, but we're not in despair. We might be persecuted, but we are not forsaken. We might be struck down, but we are not destroyed, because God, who begins a good work in you, will be faithful to complete it until the day of Christ. And no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind hath conceived what the Lord has in store for those who love him. Now unto him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we could ask or think, according to the power that is at work within us. God has given us exceeding great and precious promises. God cannot lie. All the promises of God in him are yes and amen. If you receive it tonight, would you please say amen? That's the way we talk. That's the way we talk. Say that to your mountain, and before Zerubbabel, it's nothing but rubble. Who art thou, O great mountain? Let's pray. And let's do that right now. I want to just pray over your life this doxology from Paul the Apostle, Romans 15:13. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit, which was given unto you. We're so glad you joined us for this program, Who Art Thou, O Mountain, Part 2 of Hope Generation. If you want to continue to join us on the journey of hope, listen, I believe hope is not just a one-time message you hear. It's an adventure that you go on. It's a lifestyle that you practice, because we become our habits. So get in the habit of hope. We'd love for you to join us on bencourson.com to venture on this enterprise and journey of hope. On the website, you're gonna see daily audio podcasts, our radio shows, video podcasts, short films, also our travel calendar. I might be coming to a city near you, and you can keep up with our life through the Hope account and what we're doing in the ministry. Also, we're really grateful for any financial contribution that you're able to make. Would you pray right now, perhaps about maybe a donation that you would make to Hope Generation, knowing that your gift is tax deductible, and any gift, big or small, really goes a long way in helping. Every penny you give doesn't go to a person, it goes right back into funding this show to make sure it can continue to air on this station. Until next time, this is Ben Courson signing off.